My name is Mohsen Malik. I'm the British ambassador to Indonesia, ASEAN, and Timor-Leste. It's a great honor to be asked to come and address you on your graduation ceremony and to meet these talented young people who have completed their school career and are about to embark on life's journey. I'm sure they will make the school proud. I'm sure they will make their families proud. And we wish them every success. I'd like to take a moment to congratulate not only the young people, but actually all of those who sit around them who have helped to make them who they are. The teachers, the school leaders, and of course, most importantly, the parents. We are all the product, not just of our own talents, but the environments in which we are privileged to grow up. And the love and the nurture and the care and the guidance that you would have had from your teachers, from your school leaders, from your families and your friends will make you who you are. So let's take a moment to both congratulate the class of NSA that is graduating and indeed their partners in crime. I'd also like to echo the principal's commemoration of the recent tragedy that befell Surabaya last month. I was in Jakarta when this happened, and of course, like you, I was shocked and upset and deeply saddened by these terrorist attacks that took place in Surabaya and Sidoarjo. Yesterday, on my first visit since those attacks, I took the opportunity to visit one of the churches, the Church of Pentecostal. And my purpose in visiting the church was to express solidarity, to show that when we suffer an attack like this, we are all damaged. Whether here in Surabaya, or whether us living in Jakarta, whether the people of Indonesia, or the people of the UK, whether Christians, or whether Muslims, or indeed of any other faith or ethnicity. The terrorist mindset is a criminal mindset and has and can never have any justification. These are people who deserve to be seen at the margins of society and not given the dignity of being accorded a faith or having their ideologies justified in faith. And so my purpose in going to the church in this blessed month of Ramadan was to pass on the solidarity of the British people with the Christian community of Surabaya and to relay our commitment to uphold the rights of all people in all places, including Surabaya, to follow their faith in peace, in diversity, and to fulfill their aspirations. Now, turning to my messages to these young people, I had planned a very interesting speech, but on our way in, Peter Amran told me, well, you might be on YouTube, so you haven't got anything top secret to say, have you? So I've had to ditch my top secret speech. My top secret speech you can ask me about afterwards, so instead I'll talk in slightly more general terms. I'd like to start by echoing actually two of the things that have already been said. The first is, and so the adventure begins. And the second is, as we heard from Daphne in her prayer, to be the best that we can be. Now, it may not look like it, and certainly when I was in your chair, I couldn't imagine it, but I can remember what it is like to be 17 or 18 years old. You have to look past the grey hair and the glasses, but I can remember what it was like to sit in a chair like that and think life lies ahead. And I would have looked up at somebody like me sitting in front and say, does he really know what I'm thinking or where I'm going to go? And actually, I can tell you today, standing here, that I can remember what it was like to be 17 or 18 and to embark on life's great adventure. And when you're 17 and 18 and and you're just graduating, the world is open. It's your oyster. It's right there to be taken. There are so many exciting things ahead of you. And all that you have learned from your teachers, your parents, your families, will guide and help you on that journey. And they will be there for you as you explore the opportunities that lie ahead. You will not be alone. But nevertheless, the journey is yours. The journey is yours. It is for you to define the path that you take and the opportunities that you follow and those that you leave behind and those that you use to take wings and to fly. And I wanted to recall a couple of the things that were very important in my journey as a young person. So I grew up in London. I was born in London. I'm the son of immigrants. My parents are originally from India and Pakistan. They settled in the UK in the 50s and 60s. And I was born in London and grew up there. And as a minority, as a double minority, as a Muslim and of South Asian heritage, in the UK, it was a tough place to grow up in many respects. There was a lot going on back in the UK in the 70s and the early 80s. And when I was your age, having experienced opportunity, but having also experienced racism and discrimination of various kinds, I was ready to escape. I was ready to escape where I was and to go explore the world. And there were two big things that happened to me between the ages of 18 and 21 that really opened my eyes and began that journey. The first was going to university, and the second was beginning to traveling for the first time on my own. I was lucky enough to go and study at the London School of Economics, one of the colleges of the London University. And LSE was a remarkable place. It was a place where less than half of the students were British students. It was a place where less than half of the students were, in fact, of my peer group. They were mature students. And so, arriving at LSE in the middle of London, there was no campus, there was a collection of streets. And there were all these people from all over the world who were at the university, and there were all these people who were mature students and doing PhDs and so on. And you were simply thrust into this. And it was a liberation. It was a liberation to meet people from that diverse range of backgrounds, who you could sit with, who you could talk to, who you could learn from, and who were interested in what you had to say. And it was a liberation to be able to walk out of the two or three streets in the centre of London that count as the London School of Economics, and suddenly to be anonymous in the city, to be a Londoner, to be able to drift around and go in and out of cafes and pubs and look at shows and see what was going on, but to be anonymous. And that combination of both being exposed to people different to your background, but also being in a city, in a place, in a new place, and the opportunities that created to explore, to let your mind wander, was an amazing privilege. And I know many of you are destined to go to some fabulous universities, whether here in Indonesia or abroad, but that experience of meeting other people, being in a new place, will open doors perhaps that you don't even know are there. And that connects to the second thing that really had a big influence on my journey, which was travel. Having grown up in London, I kind of knew who I was, but I didn't really know who I was. You know, you when you're 17 or 18, you are who you are. You've enjoyed listening to music or watching film or playing sport or studying maths or chemistry or whatever you really love. And you think you know who you are. But actually, my biggest learning experiences came from traveling. and discovering who I was. So when I was 18, my first summer at university, I went to the US, to Boston, and I spent 3 months cooking in a restaurant. They thought I was an illegal immigrant, actually, but I wasn't. I was there just to cook for the summer and earn some money and then go home again. But they kept promoting me. They thought I was very good at what I was doing and they were hoping I was going to stay long term. But anyway, I left at the end of the summer. But arriving in the middle of Boston, this was the USA. They spoke the same language. They ate food that looked similar. They watched television and film that was familiar to me from home. But they were different, and I hadn't really appreciated that they were different. And the thing that brought out our difference was our sense of humor. Our sense of humor. They laughed at different things to those things that I laughed at. What I found funny was not what they found funny. And in that discovery, in that moment, despite all similarities between us, I discovered their difference. But I also discovered that actually, as a son of immigrants who had grown up in London, I had a British sense of humor. It had never occurred to me that I was British. It had never occurred to me that my wiring up here had become British. And so, in that moment, I discovered not just a little bit about the USA and the people of Boston, but I learned something about myself. And on subsequent opportunities to travel, I spent time with some Tibetan Buddhists in China, as it happens. Now, I grew up as a Muslim. I am a Muslim. And growing up in any faith community, you take what you're given, and maybe you get a little complacent about it. This is how we pray. This is how you do things. This is the priest or the imam. This is what you do. You fast, whatever. And you don't necessarily think about it too much, and perhaps you don't appreciate it fully. But I spent some time with these young people who were Tibetan Buddhists, and I was excited and inspired by what they had to say, and their faith. This was exotic, this was different, this was interesting. They prayed in a different way, they thought of God in a different way, they had a different sense of the mystical and the spiritual. And it was deeply attractive and deeply interesting. But in those conversations that we had over a week or two, I learned about Tibetan Buddhism. I learned about these young people living in these western parts of China. But actually, I learned something about my own faith. I saw parallels in how they thought about prayer, and about God, and about spirituality, and about mysticism. And it echoed things that my mother and others had told me, but that I had never understood. And so in those conversations, in understanding the difference, their difference, I learned something about them. But actually, it allowed me to understand much more deeply the heritage that I had been given. And I didn't become a Tibetan Buddhist, but perhaps I learned a little bit more and understood a little bit more about my own faith. So, as you embark on your journey and the adventure that lies ahead, and strive to be the best that you can be, my top messages to you are to explore the difference. To learn from opportunities that you have at university, to travel, to learn about other places, because you will learn something about yourself. And that journey, that voyage of discovery, is actually not just about your personal journey. It's not just about your personal journey. It's also about the journey of our communities and our countries. Because we live in a world which is interconnected. The attacks in Surabaya that we talked about earlier are reported and heard about in London. When bird flu breaks out in China, we worry about it in Indonesia and in the UK. When a country builds lots of coal-fired power stations, we worry about climate change in all sorts of parts of the world. We live in a world where the things that we do here affect others around the world. We live in this famous interconnected world, this global village. It means that problems travel across borders. But it also means, it has to mean, that solutions too must cross borders. And so, if we are to create a world fit for your generation and the generations that follow, we have to learn how we can collaborate and work together across borders to tackle the problems that we all face. But to do that, you need a toolkit. To work across borders, you need a toolkit. You need to be able to communicate, and you guys are privileged to have grown up in an English language environment and have the language skills that are necessary. You need the intellectual skills, and you guys are lucky enough to have been to a fantastic school, and you will go on to great universities, and you will develop those skills that allow you to engage others. But more deeply, you need cultural understanding. You need to be able to understand not just what matters to you, but you need to be able to understand the other. You need to be able to understand those people sitting across the table from you who you are going to try and persuade to help you deal with the challenges that your communities face, whether it's extremism or climate change or economic growth or whatever it might be, or your business. You need to be able to understand why they think the way that they think. And so that journey of discovery, that journey of understanding that we talked about, is not just something that will be fun and exciting for you, but it will equip you to understand the other. And it will allow you to be more successful. Indonesia as a country has enormous potential lying ahead of it. It's the world's 16th largest economy today. It will be a top 10 economy in the next 10 years. It is a country that is the world's third largest democracy, fourth largest by population, world's largest Muslim population. This is a country that has a huge role to play in our global future. A huge role to play in our global future through the 21st century. But that success, that potential, can only be unlocked by being able to work across borders to make the world a safer and a more prosperous place. So, as you begin your journey, I wish you every success in your university courses. I wish you well for your journey of discovery. Don't forget who you are. Stay connected to your families and to your roots. Remember where you're from. Discover more about yourself. Appreciate what you have and discover what lies ahead. And know that in that voyage of discovery, you will not only be building your own success, that you will be helping to build the success of your communities and your countries. So good luck, class of 2018 SMA. Thank you very much.